we'll go ahead and start with the open forum and introductions. Carrie, do you have a list?
We have several people here today who have different things that they want to say. So maybe we'll start with Sharon Romano, who's right behind us. And before Sharon speaks, I will just say that I did send out an email to this board and the other board that I'm happy to cobble together a table for her dinner next week. And you know how I do that. So if any of you feel like you'd like to just even contribute one ticket and I'll find people to attend, I'm happy to serve in that role. But Sharon, tell us about what you have planned.
Okay, thank you, Michelle. I'll leave you with invitations. Thank you for letting me come and speak. I appreciate that. So I hope most of you are familiar with HPT. We've been around 24 years now. We're celebrating our 24th anniversary. We're a community-based organization. This fundraiser every year means a great deal to us. Right now we're employing 19 youth from Hollywood High and Helenwood City High. That's a real focus of our organization, is employing young people, planting trees, painting up graffiti, and doing things to improve the quality of life here. Today, Hollywood is a very vibrant place, but it wasn't always. And sometimes it's hard to remember that, well, it's probably a good thing. But the reason this community changed for the better was because of the people here in this bid, and very much so our police department. We had some very, very wonderful captains. And one of those wonderful captains was Michael Downey, and he served us from the late 90s, early 2000. He was here almost 6 years, and his work with this bid and everyone in this community helped transform this community into a better place. So Michael is about to be, he's been now Deputy Chief of Homeland Security for about 9 years, and he is going to retire next year. He's going to be around the police department for 30 years, and he feels it's time to retire. And we miss him. He was so wonderful, and we thought it was time to invite him back instead of Hollywood invited him. He's going to be introduced next Thursday evening by another wonderful captain of ours, Deputy Chief Pete Ramallah. So what we were hoping is that people who remember Mike, people who remember me, people who just want to show their appreciation for their efforts in the community would want to join us next Thursday night and express that appreciation. And it benefits us, and we greatly appreciate that and helps us with our work in the community. So thank you for letting me speak. Thank you for trying to put together a table. It is important to us, and we appreciate it. Thank you.
Just pretty quickly, we have a table, and we're a little bit biased. We were honored last year. We actually an honorary LABT. I have known Sharon for 20-some years that she's been here. It's a wonderful organization. I have learned so much about the environment and good practices, et cetera. It's not funny. And I would strongly urge anybody here to support its great organization.
And I will also say that Paula Poundstone is the funniest woman on the planet. And I did not want this event to end last year, but she was so fantastic. So it's terrific that you have a relationship with her, and that in and of itself is worth the price of admission.
Thank you.
So let me know. I'll reach back out to you again. Thank you, David, for finding a table. And if anybody else wants to do individual tickets, I've got 3 committed, so I just need 7 more.
Thank you very much.
And I know we have a YPI presentation, but Bronwyn, did you want to say anything?
Sure. Hi, my name is Bronwyn Kiner. I'm with Metro, Senior Community Relations Officer. I just wanted to come today and let you all know, if you didn't already, that the staff released the updated staff recommendation for Metro's LA County Traffic Improvement Plan, and that would update the original staff recommendation for a 40-year plan. So this is the new and improved fact sheet. This week and next week, the Metro Board will be deciding whether to put the potential ballot measure on the ballot in November. And I just wanted to share this updated staff recommendation with you and let you know that the Crenshaw LAX Northern Extension Project is included in this updated recommendation. This updated recommendation would include a new half-cent sales tax, as well as extend Major R's current half-cent sales tax that we're already paying in perpetuity, and that would greatly increase our ability to have a continuous funding stream to address our mobility needs for traffic. So I'm going to pass this out, and just to let you know, if you have any questions, please feel free to share them with me.
Thank you. So, Carmen, I have a question. Michael Meyer, who's not here, I don't think, had contacted us and to bring in information about this Crenshaw LAX Northern Extension of the Metro Rail, which would bring a line up on the other side of Hollywood Theater.
Yes.
So he's not here. He was planning to be here today. Maybe he's still coming.
God.
What does this have to do? Does this have anything to do with what you're working on right now?
Yes. Right now, Metro is conducting a feasibility study to study the possibility of extending Crenshaw LAX line north from its current terminus of Exposition into Hollywood. So it would go, you know, connecting with the Purple Line subway through three different routes, either La Brea, Fairfax, or La Cienega, and then connect up to the Red Line in Hollywood. Right now, the traffic improvement plan is included as a third tier project, which means it's further down, but with the new staff recommendations, it would be accelerated by 8 years. So construction would start in as soon as 2041. I know that sounds like a long way out, but it wasn't even included in the LRTP from before, not even included in the major. So it, you know, and we also putting a lot of value on shovel ready projects. So if there are schedules to change other projects, this one's shovel ready, there's the possibility that it could be further accelerated.
Okay, so I know he's seeking our support to ask for that extension. So if he doesn't come to this meeting, maybe that's
okay. And I could just add, the Chamber's been lobbying for this for over 3 years. You may recall, when they were deciding the route from the subway west, one of the routes was to Hollywood and Highland. That was going on, so they decided to go out the Wilshire route before. So that was the time when they studied this as a feasibility, as an option, the Wilshire route. So, well, the West Hollywood Chamber of Commerce, the West Hollywood are lobbying very heavily for this as well. Bronwyn, what is your phone number in case?
Oh, my phone number is 213-922-4465.
Thank you. So, we have a presentation from I'd like to tee it up.
Hello everyone. Hi, I'm Jessica Wackenhat. I work at Youth Policy Institute. And we're going to talk about, so the Housing and Community Investment Department released a request for qualifications for the Hollywood Wilcox site that's right over here a block away. And it's for three different properties. And so what they want to do is they're looking for a developer and a partner to actually develop that site. So Keith,
Sure. So hi everybody. So my name's Keith McNutt. I'm the director of the Western Region of the Actors Fund, and we're part of this partnership that is going to be bidding for the site. Was June 20th, now it's July. We're shooting for July 1st, so we don't have to work over July 4th weekend. But so the Actors Fund, for those of you who don't know, we were started back in 1882, and we did our first housing development for seniors in 1902. And we have a long history in Hollywood as well. We just celebrated our 100th anniversary of our first fundraiser ever in Los Angeles. It was a production of Shakespeare's Julius Caesar up at Beechwood with a cast of 5,000 and an audience of about 25,000. So we went up to Beechwood and then with the neighborhood council and celebrated that event. So we opened an office permanently in Los Angeles in just down in Larchmont in 1973. So we are a human service organization, and we provide a lot of emergency assistance for people in any aspect of the performing arts, not just actors. So radio, TV, film, music, opera, dance, theater, and any role within those disciplines. So we help the stagehands, we help the set designers, the performers, everybody. So our main set of services is social services and emergency financial assistance, and then we help people stabilize their lives through money management training, through finding affordable health insurance, and through finding sideline and parallel careers, and our fourth area is affordable housing. So starting in the 90s, we started partnering with other developers to build housing for low-income people in entertainment. And some of that has been supportive housing for people with disabilities. Some of it's been low-income housing for just the low-income working population. So We have 178 units in Manhattan, which is for people with HIV, low income working, and seniors. We have a 212 unit property in Brooklyn, which is half low income working people in entertainment and half formerly homeless people. So that's a really kind of beautiful mixture of arts and social service together. And then we have a building in West Hollywood, which is 40 units. It's called the Palm View. It's 40 units of housing for people with HIV and other disabilities. So we got together, going back now.
Yeah.
This project goes back about 5 years. We were hoping to build some sort of artist housing in Los Angeles. And we initially partnered with HCID and the Department of Cultural Affairs, and we're looking downtown. But we were encouraged by HCID to look at this property on between Wilcox and Trader behind Hollywood Boulevard. And so we started building a partnership that we thought made sense at that time. And we applied for the RFP that was released about a year and a half ago. And if I'm sure you guys know, the city decided to reject all applicants and fold that property into the CRA release. And so now we're doing an RFQ for qualified developers. So what we're hoping to develop is a minimum of 60 units of affordable housing for people in arts and entertainment, low-income working people in arts and entertainment. And for us, we see it every day with people coming for help from us, is that, you know, people in entertainment, particularly those who are young and starting out, are having a harder and harder time finding housing that's affordable, that's also near their work. And that's what we try to do with our housing developments. So we also are interested in the work of YPI. As I said before, we've had some experience doing services for people who are homeless with our housing. And we would like to have it be like an arts center. So it would be affordable housing, so we would bring artists to the community in perpetuity. Our mission is to make sure our housing is affordable as long as it stands. So some of the affordable housing that you see being built is only going to be affordable for 20 or 30 years, and then when the contract ends, the affordability goes away. But this, we hope, would be permanent. And so we would like to do, our original proposal in the RFP had about 2,000 square feet of community studio rehearsal space for the residents of the building, and about 20,000 square feet for nonprofit arts organizations. So some of that would be, we hope, for LACE and Woodbury University, who are already there. And we've been talking to them about what we can do, you know, even philanthropically. We may have to raise some money for the gap financing to make that space affordable enough that they can afford to stay there. But that's our intention, is to bring other nonprofit arts organizations into the building so that we can have a dynamic presence of artists and arts organizations anchored in Hollywood. And our partner, our development partner, is Thomas Saffron Associates Youth Policy Institute. And we are talking to the Recording Academy. They've been interested in the past about funding soundproof studio space in the building so that the musicians who might live there would have a place to practice their music and develop their work. So right now, I think we're pretty open to ideas and suggestions about who those nonprofit partners would be. We would love to have a youth presence, some sort of combination. So we're hoping to talk to the Harmony Project and a few other projects that involve youth in the arts, because we think that would be a nice combination.
Yeah, and so YPI was also joined into this project because it's within the Los Angeles Promise Zone. And so, as you may know, YPI is actually a multi-service organization that serves throughout the city of Los Angeles. We do a lot of educational-based work in a lot of the different schools. We're a large after-school provider, but we also have different community development initiatives that we're working in the Los Angeles region. So we have three of the White House Neighborhood Revitalization Initiatives. So our major signature initiative is actually the Los Angeles Promise Zone. You saw some of the news lately, South Los Angeles also just got awarded one. So these are high priority empowerment zones, basically, to lift people out of poverty. And so they're looking at innovative solutions within these areas and how we can strategize around federal government resources and pulling them into those locations to lift people out of poverty. So within the Promise Zone, we also have the Choice Neighborhood. So that's directly within Hollywood. And so one of the strategies that came out of that planning and the strategic plan was to develop more affordable housing within the Hollywood area, because we know that there's high need. Los Angeles is in a housing crisis, and so we're looking at all the different opportunities in which we can pool funding sources in and leverage the different partners we have. So it's pulling together a lot of different organizations throughout Los Angeles that don't traditionally work together to rethink how we can lift people out of poverty, reduce the amount of homelessness, develop more housing, all of these different types of issues that don't often interact. So that's where YPI got drawn into this project as well, as we understood that it was a major priority. So we thought it would be a great partnership. And so it's right down the street, and it's right in the middle of the Choice Neighborhood and a core component of the Promise Zone.
So I have a question for you. So the 60 units, it's all 100% affordable.
Yeah.
Are you guys open to working with other partners that you do a combination of affordable market to help offset the construction development costs?
Yeah.
So you guys, it's within your mandate to look at both, or is it you have to be 100% affordable for every unit?
Well, we started out actually hoping to do 100 units of affordable, but HCID said their cap was 60. They didn't want any more than 60. So that's how we got to that number.
Why not have another 40 in this crazy housing crisis?
Well, that's what we thought, but that's not what they thought. So, you know, they're the boss. But the original partnership involved the Actors Fund is ArtSpace, and ArtSpace is the co-developers, and it was going to be kind of a condo split. So there would be the affordable housing component with the nonprofit space, and then CalArts was actually going to do 65,000 square feet for their graduate theater program and their youth outreach programs. But the timing, because the RFP was rejected, it backed us into the time when CalArts president is resigning and retiring, and CalArts no longer felt like they could make a commitment. So they would have been part of the project if it happened a year and a half ago. They can't be a part of it now. So that leaves a large portion of the original concept open for creative thinking. So we are trying to work with TSA to see what the other options are. And one of the things they brought up is maybe we could do some market rate units as well. And I think that would make it very attractive, you know, to be in artist housing for anybody who wanted to live in Hollywood. So that may be what helps the project pencil out in the absence of CalArts.
I'll also add that part of it is the parking structure that's operated by the Department of Transportation that's behind the building. So that will be fully put into place in the building as well, and it will still be operated by LADOT. So they're going to replace all of more than what's already there right now and add in more bicycle parking into that location as well. So that's required.
Displacement plus parking for the residents, plus parking if we have any kind of. One of the things that's been thrown around, Actors Equity Association has been interested, and actually Jeff and I have to talk at some point, that they were hoping that some sort of black box rehearsal space could be found. We did, when we first started the project, we did surveys of all of Los Angeles, and what we heard from the 120 or 130 arts organizations that responded was that the studio, the rehearsal space, is one of the toughest things to make happen at an affordable rate. So if there's some way for us to fit that in, we would love to fit that in for the, you know, the dance and the music and the theater communities here.
Okay.
Thank you guys for having us in.
So I can give my contact, Joe has my contact information. So if you're willing to write a letter of support for us, you can sign it and scan it. And I actually have one that's already written out, and you just need to fill in your organization name and sign it. So it's pretty easy and already done for you, put on your letterhead. And so we could take those, and that would be greatly appreciated before it's due. And so we would like that back by June 24th, so a week from tomorrow.
We'll just send that out to everybody, and then they can.
That'd be great.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thanks, everybody.
Warm it up,
Monica. Come on.
Yep. So we are only just very open forum, and I wonder if anything else. Everyone is taking minutes. If you have any questions.
Sure.
Thank you, Evan.
Second.
Thank you, David. All in favor?
Aye, Paul.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? Okay. Important business. Mark, what is your question?
Sure. So, yeah, Gerson didn't send over the financials until, must have been on my walk over here.
Yeah.
So I don't feel comfortable putting this in front of the board for approval just yet. Just a couple things I did notice, and Joe, you and I don't want to take note of this. They're still accruing for accounting fees, even though we've hit our max. So maybe I should send an email to Nas, being that I just got off the phone with her on Monday, and I'll talk about that in the next board meeting. We can get approval on this. And then as far as the one-year agreement goes, they also sent over the written agreement just today, but looking at it, it looks pretty similar to last year's, Joe. There is a not to exceed of $65,000, which is good. We asked her to put that in there. Looks like they still want a bill on an hourly basis, but not to exceed $65,000, which I think is acceptable. The only other thing was the third paragraph of billing and payment. I don't know if this is in last year's agreement or not, where we have 30 days to submit any written disagreement.
We're just talking about that.
Okay.
Sure you got your...
There's also a couple things missing in the scope of services in this letter as compared to last letter. We just got this proposal today. So we just need to ask why they removed some of these other deliverables.
So should we wait on this also?
Yeah, or Monica,
I have a motion to approve these of the budget subject to review of the terms of the agreement.
Perfect.
I think from our standpoint, there's just a couple things, and Mark touched on it, is just making sure that it's confusing to what the cap is. It's 65,000, but then it goes on to talk about the hourly, like Jerry said, the bullet points that got removed. So, yeah, we can, if Monica said, we can approve it with some of these kind of things and making those corrections.
Okay.
So,
I'll make that motion.
Thank you very much.
Second.
Thank you, David. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? And abstentions? Okay. Thank you. New business.
So this Mr. Michael Meyer is not here. He walked in, so he had asked for time on the agenda today, so we'll move on to him.
Okay, great. Alyssa?
I'm actually going to kick this off with a presentation. So first I want to acknowledge and thank Mark, Alyssa, Jeff is here from the committee, Joe, for your guys' help in this process. We've been talking about our current situation with our present maintenance vendor. And we've been, over the past few months, keeping the board apprised of where we are. I'm not seeing the monitor right now. Just use this. So over the past few months, we've been keeping the board apprised of where we are with Clean Street, who is our current maintenance vendor. And you might recall that Joe and I met with their executive team back in March. We had lunch with their team, and we kind of expressed the specific issues that we were having. And we left that meeting with a pretty clear game plan on how we were going to fix those issues. So Clean Street has responded to a few of those requests. It's taken quite a few months. We just got the final maintenance schedule last week, so they have responded, but it's been a slow process. And as you can see, we have a long history with Clean Street. They've been our maintenance vendor since 1999. And the issues that we're currently experiencing are not new issues. We've been having these kind of similar problems for a while, and the pattern that keeps repeating itself is we'll express our concerns, they'll kind of clean up their act for a while, but then there's always a slow kind of gradual decline in human services. So this is the pattern that we keep seeing. So during the 2013 RFP process, Clean Street did bid on the contract once again, and the committee, and Mark and Jeff, you guys might be able to add more to this, I wasn't around then, but the committee was not totally comfortable in re-awarding that contract to Clean Street, but they were put on a 90-day probation period because they had made a lot of new promises, ways to improve their systems, and during that 90-day period, the committee was satisfied with their performance, and they were then extended the contract once again. But again, the service was started to decline after that. So, so from our perspective, they respond with immediate fixes, but the changes are never sustained. We believe the problems are systemic and from internal management issues, and we feel that it's time to start to explore our options once again. So I'm gonna kind of jump into the issues. The bottom line is not all of the work is being done, and we think it's because of these issues that are outlined up here. So lack of accountability is the first issue. There's little oversight of the daily maintenance activities. We don't have any systems in place to track the work that's being done. We don't know where the guys are out in the field, what they're doing, or when they're doing it. There's no work order systems to assign or delegate tasks to verify when they've been completed. And right now the process is if we ask for something to be done, we relay that to our maintenance supervisor, who will call the guys in the field, ask them to do something. And if we want to know when it was done or if it's done, we have to once again call the maintenance supervisor. He has to call the field workers, and then that's how we confirm the work has been done. So it's very inefficient right now. And we've been having issues with our maintenance supervisor. We don't feel that he has enough oversight from their corporate team. An example to support that, we found out that our trees were not being watered for about a month of time, and I noticed the trees were turning brown. We were still receiving logs that said that the work had been done, but it wasn't, and we lost a couple of those trees that we had just planted. Of course, Clean Street paid to replant them, but we were being lied to in that situation. And we also have had a couple of complaints from some of the maintenance workers about the reliability of our maintenance supervisor. So that's of concern to us as well. So no quality control or proof of compliance. I've already touched on this, but there's no protocols to verify that the work is being done per the contract. We requested a series of master schedules back in March, and as I mentioned, we just got the last one last week. I was a little concerned to learn that a schedule didn't actually exist for pressure washing in the Sunset District. The work was being done, but they didn't have a strict schedule that they were following, which is problematic when we get calls from stakeholders. We should be able to answer when it was last done and when it will be done next. And on that note, we have been getting a couple of complaints from property owners about dirty sidewalks and things like that. So inefficient operations infrastructure, we do not get a whole lot of attention from the corporate team. They don't ever come out to the district to spot check or verify the condition of the district, and we've been working with them through the past 10 years to fix these problems. I feel that our maintenance supervisor is overextended. He's responsible for all of the daily activities as well as the scheduling and reporting. And they currently use their cell phones to communicate with each other. They submit handwritten logs, which I get a stack of these each week, and it's really up to me to kind of figure out what this is trying to tell us, and so this information isn't being compiled at all. Constantly having to ask for things twice, and the equipment from our perspective is not representative of this district brand that we've worked hard to create. The trucks are beat up, the doors don't open from the outside, the windows aren't operable, things like that. So we would love to use the equipment as a way to brand ourselves with our logo and what have you, but right now it's not up to the level that we expect it should be. And insufficient reporting and data collection. This is increasingly important as we get closer to bid renewal. We're not currently compiling any data, the reports that are being submitted, these logs, are not being verified by Clean Streets corporate team, so we cannot say that the information we're receiving is even accurate. So that's kind of the problem. That's where we are right now. So what are our options? Oh, actually, let me touch on this slide here. So if we are looking to get out of this contract, we have to make sure we're doing it in a legally sound way. So Joe and I have been working closely with our legal counsel to make sure we have a solid case to exit this contract if the board supports this idea of doing that. Our attorney's confident that the termination would hold up in court if it was contested, but again, of course, our attorney cannot guarantee that we would win, or cannot guarantee that Clean Street might try to fight this if we exit the contract. But he is confident that we would win in court if it got to that. There is a 10-day curable in the contract, which we've addressed via email. I mentioned some of the things were provided, but most of the asks were not addressed, and simply because we don't think they're able to. Per the contract, these are the provisions that we can rely on, 7D and 7A8. And we've been compiling a memo to file. It's about 3 pages long of roughly 20 incidents that kind of prove that the work is not being done for the contract. So we have that to fall back on as well. So this brings us to Street Plus. Street Plus was, I guess I'll call it the runner-up in our 2013 RFP process. What it really came down to, and Jeff and Mark jump in if this is inaccurate, but the committee was a little unsettled by the fact that they didn't have a strong West Coast presence. So if, you know, equipment was to break down and what have you, or if we needed new equipment, how would we get that? Would it be timely enough? But since then, they have actually opened a West Coast headquarters in downtown Los Angeles. So they are now local. And we reached out to Street Plus to see if they would still be interested in honoring their 2013 proposal with a CPI increase. And of course, they were more than willing. They are, you know, excited about that opportunity. And they said if we were to award them the contract, this would really be their crown jewel of the 50 contracts they hold. So they're excited about that. Steve Hilliard, he's the president of Street Plus, he came to the last committee meeting, talked about the proposal, answered questions that the committee had, and it was a great productive meeting. So a little bit more background on Street Plus. They've been providing bid services longer than any other vendor in that field. They still hold their very first contract that they were awarded. They have 50 contracts. They have a couple of bids in Los Angeles, and they've never lost a contract. But before I jump into some of the highlights from their proposal, I just wanted to open it up to the committee to see if you guys had kind of your first impressions or thoughts about that meeting and their proposal.
They seemed to answer all of our questions and things we wanted to hear. They reassured us that a transition would be really seamless and quick, and that they needed, I think he told us a week, and he could have everyone in place with temporary uniforms and ready to go, orders in for the permanent ones. Did seem very excited about it, and that they would be here checking in every once a month, someone comes out from,
I think there's management infrastructure that was truly impressive, and the support, when we talk about the lack of support from the current vendor, that the support structure is in place both locally and nationally, and being an industry leader, I think is impressive. You haven't delved into the financials, but you know, for the, when you talk about just the CPI increase, it didn't even bat an eye. I think that was a great sort of way to retouch base and reestablish the conversation. And there are things that we haven't talked about, but their internal operations on the technology side are truly impressive, whether it's from scheduling to employee tracking, that I think we'll realize a tremendous benefit in terms of the reporting structure that will allow us to be able to respond to the entire bid in detail with detailed questions when they come to us.
They also really seem to care about the neighborhood, and they wanted all of their employees to care about the neighborhood and know all the landmarks and to make eye contact with people on the streets and be available for questions and not just be there to have their heads down and sweep.
Their training protocol is 54
yes.
hours. And a good chunk of that is the neighborhood and understanding the neighborhood and where the restaurants are and where the parking structures are, so that they truly are our brand ambassadors on top of maintenance. It's the things that we want.
That's a huge bonus.
Yeah. And they're branded as an extension of the bid, so it's not a Street Plus brand. It's the bid brand that's out
there. Well, I think that's what we're requesting in
the vendor. Yeah. It's
so
fantastic.
Yeah. So, I'll go ahead and just talk a little bit. You guys touched on a lot of the good stuff, but an overview of what the staff structure would look like. As Jeff, you just mentioned, the ambassadors would have a hospitality focus, so they really are trained to interact with people out on the street. They serve kind of a dual purpose of offering directions and things like that. So we would have a shift supervisor as well as a program manager. And these would all be working positions out on the street. They would be headquartered in our bid service center up on Cherokee, which we're currently paying rent for. Clean Street is not using it to its fullest potential right now. It's more so a storage and kind of bathroom stop area. But Steve and his team would really use it as an office, and they have, you know, telephones and computers, and I think they would use it better than Street is using it right now. And the main differences from our current setup, of course, the hospitality focus on our ambassadors, and these ambassadors would have much higher visibility than we do now. They would all have actual uniforms. They would have branded shirts and hats, and they'd be outfitted with walkie-talkies, and all of their equipment would have our brand colors, our logos, so it would be a very high visual impact out on the street. This is the proposed capital equipment that we've been talking about, and this is kind of what we've based our budget numbers off of so far. We have two options for this equipment, either purchasing it or leasing it. And if we decide to lease, it would be a lower cost, obviously, than the purchase price. But again, these numbers are the purchase price numbers. So this is kind of our worst case scenario.
Green Street, I didn't see on the financials that we actually have any assets in terms of machinery.
You're right.
This is something that's totally different.
Yeah, and we can, we'll talk a little bit more about the financials at the end, but yeah, this is new. This would be, we are recommending that we would lease this equipment. equipment, so the cost would be lower than the purchase price. They brought in one of their sweepers and did a live demonstration for us, so you know, they went the extra mile of actually bringing some equipment in, so that was cool to see. Two-way radios, again, we are not currently utilizing that kind of technology. It's all iPhone, you know, they use their personal phones to communicate with each other. They've included furniture and office equipment to really outfit the service center. So those are some of the capital equipment highlights.
How does this come into the new software that you just purchased last month?
So I will also talk about that in just a moment. It's their what they call their Staff View technology. And I just wanted to say that all of the capital equipment costs includes the cost of insuring the equipment and also the maintenance costs as well. Thanks for the segue. So as a part of their proposal, they do have a proprietary software that they've developed with a company called GeoPal. And we've actually met with GeoPal at a couple of the downtown conferences. So they have a big presence in the bid world. But they've created their own technology that is similar to the technology that the board approved last month. If we were to decide to go this direction instead, we do think this would be a better option. We have not executed the move on upgrading that last software, so we'd be saving about $3,000 by not doing that.
Yeah, I think, let me just speak to that quickly. And the committee was there and they saw what this software is capable of, and in Matthew's wisdom, we didn't sign the agreement yet with Stack FM to go forward with the development. And because we had a feeling that this might come up. And what we found is originally we were leaning towards doing the Stack FM for the maintenance side. And as the committee saw what their software was capable of, and we were assured that all the data in it, should we ever change vendors again, would come back to us. It would be our property if we needed it, if we chose to do that or not. In regards to the maintenance issues that they would track, what we decided was that we felt like this was a much more robust and kind of plug-and-play system for their operations. It's what they're typically trained on and know already. And so what we went back to Stack FM and said was, if we were to kind of negate or just remove the maintenance component of the proposal that you all approved last month, that we would have savings. And it was significant savings. It's about $6,000 total, so $3,000 savings for each bid, which means our cost for the software now would only be $3,500 to redo the development. And then what would happen with that is that we would continue to use Stack FM for the assessment data, and then also for the security incidents, and it would be strictly solely mapping incident occurrences. So it would just be basically looking at where incidents are occurring in the bid and using it for similar kind of uses we do now for security. But the maintenance component would be strictly used and kept in the Staff View system. And so we would have that savings on the development side with Stack FM if we chose to go that route.
Yeah, Joe, you touched on a lot of the benefits of using this as opposed to Stack FM. And from my perspective, this Clean Street, Street Plus rather, would really be at the helm of this software. They would be the folks training all of their staff how to use it. They'd be the ones who would be generating the reports at our request. So we would not have that burden of making sure information is being inputted. That would really be up to them.
I'm sorry, on the security portion, we signed 13, but we approved $3,000
for an upgrade to that software system. And this is $10,000, is that the same?
No, this is not. This is included in their maintenance
okay.
contract.
And then what are we going to do for the upgrade? Are we not going to upgrade the system?
No.
Or is it just components?
So yeah, it's just components. So what happens is essentially we have two softwares. One software, which would be solely for maintenance, which would be this, and then the other is Stack FM, which is the proposal we approved last month, and that would take the place of continuing to manage our parcels and security.
So we still need an upgrade, but it's a smaller portion because we're not that like maintenance.
Exactly. And so that's where the savings of $3,000 would come back to us, because we take you know, the maintenance component. Mm-hmm.
And our share of $13,000 was
$6,000. Yeah. And Alyssa and Joe, you both were there for the demonstration of this software. It can do anything that you want it to. He was telling Jeff, they have a map that shows by GPS where all the workers are, and you can do a rewind to trace their trail. So it's very, it would be difficult to outsmart the system. You can
questions on this?
Oh, it's a little bit more. I can speed it up. So I wanted to touch on their recruiting and training program. They really place an emphasis on this stuff. They tout it as industry-leading hiring and training practice. Only 2% of the people who apply for jobs get a job, but this is the process, and they do offer the bid to kind of be a part of that if you'd like to. This is an outline of what their training procedures are. They require a total of 60 training hours, everything from interacting with people on the streets to dealing with homeless. They do have to take a test for each of these things. They get a certification at the end, and there's a lot of ongoing training as well. And then the quality assurance piece, which I love, they've got a lot of procedures in place to really show that they're doing the work, to hold them accountable. There's a dedicated support services coordinator who'll be available at any time to answer questions regarding our account. We would have account visits from the president of the company every other month, but every month to start. And they have a built-in program evaluation and audit, so they do a self-audit each quarter. They invite the bid to participate, and they'll work with us to strategize on any issues that came out through that audit. And then they have all of these, their credits, if they miss certain things per the contract. So, for example, if they don't get the staff uniforms when they say they will, then they'll credit us $1,000 on our invoice. So these are, you know, safeguards in place to make sure we get what they promise. Okay, so budget highlights. This is my last slide here. So looking at this chart, you can see that
it's in your packets.
These costs are built into the proposal amount. So we're proposing a 29-month contract, which covers the remaining life of the bid. And the chart here shows the equipment is amortized over 36 months. But this is the worst-case scenario, again, for the purchase of the equipment. Working with Street Plus, we determined that leasing would be a better option for us, and we could amortize that that cost over the 29-month contract. So again, the lease would likely bring down our overall contract costs. We believe it would be less than what's shown here. So in every scenario, we are under budget for what we have budgeted for maintenance each year.
Question on these, on the budget, I can't recall exactly on these sweepers, the 40,000, two of them for 40, are these one of the larger ones or the smaller ones that they?
It's a smaller one. Yeah.
Small ones are 40 each. Mm-hmm.
The 41,000 include the amortization of the 36 months. Is that included in the 863 total?
No, it's not. It would be the remaining residual value. So, well, that's if we purchase, and we're not leaning towards purchasing.
Okay, so what is the cash? What is our cash position? Forget about amortization or whatever it is. What is our total monthly cash basis? Comparing one contract to the other.
So that would be this number here, the 83.
And if you wanted to just add $791 to that, and that would be over 29 months. That would be our total monthly cost for, in the worst case scenario. Obviously, we would probably have lower capital costs because we had lease it.
So okay. The nature of the motion, you want to describe the logic on that?
Yes, so what we are asking for today, so we're asking for authorization in conjunction with the Streetscape Chair and the Chair of the Board to have the ability to exercise our 30-day termination notice with Clean Street. Obviously, there's a lot of things that we would need to get lined up in advance before we felt comfortable to do that. Obviously, there's a lot of footwork to get the next vendor lined up in time so that we have a smooth transition. So that is the ask today.
How many days is needed? Because I thought you could jump out immediately.
Yeah, I mean, it's I think
I mean, we'll have to talk in greater detail. There is a section of his proposal that clearly lays out the transition plan, but he said in one account, I think it was up in San Francisco, one of their maintenance vendors quit and they came in on a week's notice. It was kind of a fire drill, but obviously if we could have more time to make that.
He said best case scenario was 30 days. Yeah. Like, so if you were gonna terminate on a 30-day notice, that to ramp up, get the ads out, get employees, that 30 days is ideal.
Yeah, I mean, the concern that I have with the motion here is if it's warranted. I think you've demonstrated that it is warranted to move forward. So I think the wording of, you know, this may be, I would like it to be a little.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah, we need to get even before we make it.
I do have a question though. So you said earlier you appointed the contract, they have a 10-day cure period. So what triggers the 10-day cure period? Have you guys already put that in a motion?
Yeah, so in okay. consultation with our attorney, we did take care of that curable. Okay. Yes, and we, as I mentioned, we got a response, but they did not cure all of the issues.
There's just a few items. So what we talked about with Jeff and what Jeff advised us to is that essentially it's a 10-day cure and we put them on an email notice because now we had asked for a couple items back in March that we still were waiting on. And they sent probably 90% of those items. 10% of them were still outstanding. And so what we went back to Jeff and kind of were trying to decide if there was grounds for us to do this, to which Jeff was saying he feels comfortable with the fact that we've given them many opportunities to cure already. And to up until this point, they have always cured, but Jeff was saying it's kind of like, you know, you have a car that keeps breaking down and you keep bringing it in, and it's like at some point you just got to get rid of the car, because even if it's covered under warranty, you got to figure out how to make this thing.
But it seems as though from the presentation, they haven't delivered any of the schedules, they haven't delivered, you know, there's a lot that seems to still be outstanding, so I just don't think they've fulfilled their cure period.
There's definitely things that are still outstanding, for sure. So Jeff was saying that that combined with Matthew's memo to file, that he feels like we have a strong enough reason to exercise the 30 day if we can. He just wanted to caution because he said, you know, I can't always guarantee what's gonna happen, but he said, I feel comfortable enough that if you were to exercise the 30 day option, that there's enough between what Matthew's given me and what we're needing, then I think we'd be okay.
When does the current contract expire?
2018.
Mm-hmm.
So there's some money on the table.
There's some money on the table.
Okay,
so there's no termination, right? So I think you have a contract, you have a termination, not, I mean,
right, so what happened is, and this is, again, I don't know how this happened or what occurred, but in our previous contract with Queen Street, we had a 30-day out for any reason whatsoever. We were satisfied, we had 30 days, and thanks for no thanks, we're out here. When we renewed with the RFP for whatever reason, I don't know how this happened or occurred, but they put in that 10-day cure that was never there before in the old contract. And so that is where we're getting kind of hung up on right now. That's what we keep going back with the attorney on, because in the old contract, to your point, Monica, it was like that. And I don't know what changed or why that changed, but when we renewed in 2013 after the RFP, that was put back in, or that was put in, excuse me, it was never there before.
Well, I mean, I remember in 2013 when we did the Get Street Plus, they were extremely, they looked good to us.
And one thing we didn't bring up in this, but I think is impactful for me, is the conversation about how they have created a program and staffing to address the transient population in other cities. And that so there is an option where they bring in certified trained folks to deal with the homeless population. So less about that's an option for us in the future, but more about that the company is thinking about that. So in their training with this staff, they're also prepared and have the tools and skill sets to be able to train even just the street cleaners how to think about it and how to approach it. And I think that's, given our current situation, hugely impactful.
Well, yeah, I mean, given what we went through in 2013, Clean Street knew we were not happy with them, and we continue to not be happy with them. I think we do need to change. And even though the bid renewal is coming up, that's not an excuse to just keep status quo. We need to show that we're improving and we need to improve things. And so I'm for a change to Street Plus. And if Jeff, who we trust as counsel, says that, you know, we've got the legal right to do it, then let's do it.
One other question too, since you never know what's gonna happen, hopefully everything is gonna be fine. What kind of agreement is there for early termination with Street Plus and?
Well, we have to bring a contract back to you to approve.
Yeah, we.
Has that been discussed at all with them or?
I've kind of put the brakes on and because I wanted to, I mean, our protection for the board, I feel like it's our obligation as staff, so I really wanted to make sure that Jeff was on board with this. And so we have held off asking for a draft contract or anything from them until we know for sure that we can proceed and the board has given us our blessing to even exercise this 30-day. And then from there, depending on that, we would have to, yes, we would get a draft contract, and to Carrie's point, we would probably shoot for approval at the next board meeting of that contract. We would have Steve here. He would be more than, he was happy to come today, but I, like I said, I really wanted to kind of just slow it down a little.
I would rather see the draft contract before you terminate the current contract, because you can be stuck.
Well, we can do that even for the leadership to look at.
Yeah, that's.
Before we even pull the trigger.
That can be done.
We did ask him, the committee did ask him that though, and he said, we can address that in the contract, but we've never lost a customer at the same time.
Yeah.
There's always a first, but.
Well, that's why we're asking for the flexibility to issue that 30-day notice once we've seen a draft contract and know that it's something that, you know.
The one thing Steve did say when we had a call with him this week, Matthew and I, is that their contracts have a 30-day out for any reason. There's no curable in their contract. So we would look to have that again in whoever we end up continuing. So that was the one thing he did say to us on the phone. There's a 30-day out for any reason. If you're not happy, you're out.
Looks like there's a lot of things that you considered.
They've been working very hard on this. Very thorough contract.
Right. So we're looking for action or motion.
What's the motion again?
Well, it would be this motion, which I know.
Yeah, how would you want to tweak it?
Well, I guess the question, now that we don't know what the contract is, and if warranted is okay, I just didn't want any confusion because I think you're presenting an argument that seems as though it's warranted, and I didn't want any issue with that.
Do we need an action? I mean, if we get the agreement from Street Plus next board meeting, can we have an action to terminate, 3-day terminate with Clean Street and engage with Street Plus?
Maybe next month, right?
Yeah,
because
you can't
terminate without having the contract in place.
You need to know what other pool you're jumping into.
Exactly.
Sure.
Okay.
Is that fair?
Yeah. So, thank you guys for doing a great job on that.
And it took a lot of time on this, so I'll just kind of quickly go through the remaining items for Streetscape agenda. We've got a flyer in your packet. It should be the next page. This is the draft flyer, what we created for the utility box art project that was approved at the last month's board meeting. This is what we'll use for our marketing and outreach. This will be plugged into a website, a web page on our website. And we also have the application form up and running that will be on our website as well. So we are moving forward with that. Just wanted to give you a quick update. Following item in your packet is a letter that was sent in response to the city's request for input for the community plan update. We just wanted to let you know that we did submit this letter. I believe everyone got an email asking folks to do the same. So just wanted to show everyone that was done.
I just want to commend the bid for doing that. It's very important that we get positive letters out.
And it was a great attendance by a lot of board members who both defend the chamber and had scoping sessions.
And then the last item, the action would be a little bit different on this one, but you've got a couple of sheets in the packet that show some proposed changes to the city's tree trimming ordinance, which we are very concerned about, considering we trim all of the trees along the Walk of Fame once annually. It's close to 400 trees, and the permitting process to get that done as it is now is already difficult. The city is proposing to tackle on about five or six other layers of bureaucracy on top of the process. A billboard company trimmed some trees in Silver Lake illegally. The community was very upset, so the city is trying to figure out how to stop that from happening, but we don't believe the recommendations as proposed are the right way of doing that. There's still a lot of things we don't know yet, which is why we don't have a draft letter ready for you to review. But one thing that's very scary is that they're proposing a $200 permit fee per tree, as we understand it so far. So that's a huge cost that we would be
incurring for the tree.
So yeah, we're concerned. We brought this to the big consortium's attention. So we're going to try and rally the troops and come up with a recommended revision as related to the work that the bids do. I think the motion we're seeking is approval to oppose the
proposal.
Yes.
Because didn't we talk to Mitchell for those all his regards?
So I'm waiting to hear back from their legislative team, but we just found out about this on Tuesday, so there's a lot of unknowns still.
Do we know how fast it's moving?
So I believe it's being heard on the 26th of this month. BSS is going to be hearing this at the committee level. So right now, these are just kind of the city's first response to Mitch's motion for additional information. So I do think that there's still time to give our input.
Yeah, and it doesn't, it penalizes the law-abiding, bids and whatnot. They're trying to go after the van that comes in at midnight with no markings on the truck and comes in and hacks a tree under a billboard and then drives off. And that's, what precipitates it. Well, those folks aren't going to follow this policy at all. So we'd like to oppose it and say, we have some other ideas. Like, we have seen those trucks pull into the neighborhood and start trimming trees. We know they don't have a permit. Who do we call? Can LAPD be called? Can you take a picture and take a picture of the license plate and then there could be some infraction. Those are the road tree trimmers that they're trying to go after. This is overkill. Not only do they want $200 per tree, it will take a picture of every tree before you trim it and a picture of every tree after you trim it.
Yeah, and they're planning to hire two tree surgeons to actually physically come out and inspect the trees before and after. So
what qualifies you to be a tree surgeon, I wonder?
And our tree trimmers are certified arborists as it is, so. Today it's no fee for a tree trimming permit. So,
how much?
It's
no fee.
Yeah, so the $200 fee is to pay for these proposed tree searches.
Well, I'm hosting fundraising for Mitch on the 27th. So I'll talk to him about it.
Can I just bring up one thing real quick? Can we just go back to number one? I just thinking about things and looking at the spreadsheet. So. The reason why we're looking to actually exercise that 30-day option today is because of the 29-month lead on the contract. And so with each, assuming that we would start in August, and the reason being for that is to stay within our budget parameters going forward. I know we don't have the draft contract, but if there's some way that we could agree to send that out or something and get it sooner, I would feel more comfortable if we were able to do that. The other thing is that I feel like Clean Street is starting to spend money, we've noticed, and we don't want them to spend any more money if we're not gonna go forward with them. And so that's another concern that I have personally, just putting it out on the table. If you want us to wait till the next meeting.
Well, are they spending money on improving what we don't like? I mean, that.
Yeah, it's like.
Because that could be used against us.
Right, and that's what I'm saying. Like, they just bought a new truck the other day.
But they didn't buy a truck. They relocated one to our district, so.
What, they didn't purchase it?
They didn't purchase it. It was an existing truck, but they are starting to reallocate some things. And I don't think we want them to get any further along on that.
Yeah, I mean, ultimately, I would be with Monica on this, but I'd want to see what an agreement moving forward looks like before we get it.
Okay.
Otherwise,
so if we don't wait, well, the next board meeting is 30 days, so then that means we'll be 60 days out. Can we, does anybody want to be, we'll have Jeff Briggs review it, and of course the committee, staff, I'll review it, maybe executive committee, if anybody else wants to review the contract, maybe we have a motion that subject to review of, the new vendor's contract.
Well, yeah, that motion's not on the agenda.
Oh, yeah.
But one thing we can always do is if staff feels as though this thing needs to be addressed sooner rather than later, we can have an emergency meeting of the board. We did that last year for, 45 minutes, whatever, and deal with it earlier.
That was.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, thanks for bringing that up.
Yeah, no problem.
But you're in the midst of a motion.
Yeah.
Sorry.
In terms of the tree pruning.
I'll move that, which.
Okay.
Just gonna post this proposal.
Yeah, thank you.
Sorry.
Thank you. I'm all in favor.
I asked if you'd get us a copy of your letter, maybe we could write a letter of support of it.
It's a pretty busy time for our.